the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God,
have mercy on us.
We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves to the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do.
Turn us again to you,
and hold us by your Spirit,
so that we may live and serve you in this life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
Lord, need for our
you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Let them give thanks to you, Lord, for your steadfast love and your wonderful works for all people.
Let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving, and tell your deeds with shouts of joy.
A reading from Ephesians. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Of love.
Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord. Save us as you promised. We will trust your word. The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
met some famous people. I've met some famous people, and I have to say, although there are some people who really love to be in the presence of celebrities, I'm not necessarily one of them. I've always kind of felt let down after meeting the famous person. I mean, after all, the meeting was not really significant. It was pretty superficial. After the meeting, I didn't know any more about the person than I had before I met them. And so I never really got that excited about meeting famous people. There was no serious exchange or dialogue in the conversation. Nothing of substance. It was just a hello, how are you, or maybe let me get my picture taken with you so I can send it to all of my friends. Seems kind of hollow to me. Now, the meeting that took place in the gospel, that was significant. That was significant because Nicodemus came to Jesus. Now, as the story goes, we don't get the first part of the conversation, the prelude to the conversation. We just know that Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. He was a learned professor of the law and the Jewish tradition. And he comes to Nicodemus, comes to Jesus by night, and the conversation starts off very polite and nice. He says, "Teacher, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher from God because no one can do the things that you are doing unless they are from God." Now, immediately after that, things go south. And it's like Jesus and Nicodemus aren't connecting because Nicodemus is on a very physical plane, and Jesus is on a very spiritual plane. And all these non-sequiturs happens. It doesn't seem to connect either one with the other. Nicodemus doesn't seem to get exactly what Jesus is talking about. But for me, the real surprise is that comes toward the end of the conversation, the beginning of our gospel lesson, where Jesus goes into the snake story. You know, the numbers 21 that we just heard as our first lesson about the people of that were following Moses, wandering around in the desert, and they were complaining, they were grumbling and whining about their life and about the lack of food, or specifically the lack of good quality food. And so they're grumbling and complaining, and God sends down snakes upon them that bite the people. Some of them die, but then they cry out, and God tells Moses to make this bronze snake, put it on a pole, and anybody that looks to the snake will look and will live. That's such a strange story, isn't it? I mean, really, if God sent down snakes to bite everyone who whined or grumbled, well, we definitely got a shortage of snakes on our hands, don't we? And I think there would be a snake with my name on it as well, because I sometimes can grumble, and I surely can whine. Why doesn't Jesus talk about what are the great stories? Now, why don't you go back to Noah or Abraham or talk about, you know, Jacob, or talk about maybe Moses or King David or something like that, something big in Israel's history? Why this story? It's such a strange story. Why does Jesus bring it up here? Well, he does it because he's saying that just as Moses lifted up that bronze snake, which is an image of terror, that he will be lifted up on another image of terror. Mainly, he will be crucified on the cross. But to everybody that looks to the cross, they will be saved. You know, I think there's a really interesting story that happens to what happens to this bronze snake that most people don't hear about. They hear about the bronze snake in Numbers 21, and they hear about it in the third chapter of John's Gospel. story that's really fascinating. At least it is to me, and it comes in 2 Kings, the 18th chapter. It's about the righteous King Hezekiah. And the righteous King Hezekiah wants to make reforms on the way that Israel is practicing its faith, and he wants to cleanse the temple. And one of the things he does is he gets rid of this snake. They gave it a name. They called it Nehushtan. You can read this in the 18th chapter of 2 Kings. Because what happened was they put this snake in the temple. Now, get this. Hundreds of years ago, Moses made this bronze snake. They've been carrying this all the way through the wilderness, all into the new promised land. And then, whenever they erected a temple, they put that snake in there. And people were actually offering incense to that snake and worshiping it. That's why Hezekiah broke it up and threw it out of the temple. Because they had turned what was a gift from God into an idol. Now, before we shed too much shade on those people in Israel, I think we need to look at ourselves, because oftentimes this is a problem that we have, indeed all humanity has, that oftentimes we take something good that God has given to us, and instead of giving thanks to God who gave it to us, instead of worshiping Him, we worship the gift. We fail to see that it's not the gift that is so important as the one who is the giver of gifts. Now, I'm not saying that Nicodemus wanted to worship a snake. He didn't do that. But I do believe that Nicodemus had such a fixed view of who God was, and he believed that his view of God was so complete that it didn't allow for anything new or surprising. And sometimes a narrow definition of who God is can become something of an idol. Not God, but our naive, small misconception about who God actually is. That can become an idol. And I think we need to ask ourselves, are we open to a faith that has the ability to make us uncomfortable? That has the ability to surprise us? That has the ability to change our minds? No, not just our minds, our lives as well. Jesus, in that conversation, was full of surprises for Nicodemus. Jesus is full of surprises for us as well. The resurrection was the biggest surprise, right? Crucified on Good Friday, rose from the dead on Easter Sunday. And we that live on the other side of that empty tomb, I think sometimes we're the ones that believe we have it all figured out. After all, this is the fourth Sunday of Lent. Next comes the fifth Sunday of Lent. We know Palm Sunday's after that. And Easter's Jesus risen from the dead on Easter Sunday. A couple weeks from now. We have it all figured out. But here's the thing I want you to consider. After Jesus rose from the dead, he was still full of surprises. You know, there's that fishing trip in the Gospel of John, the 21st chapter. There's his appearances to all of the people, his ascension, the story about him waking up Paul on the road to Damascus, and then the surprise of John, who wrote the Gospel in the book of Apocalypse, says that he saw the risen Christ, one like the Son of Man, among the seven churches in Asia Minor. His presence was still there. Jesus is a very surprising God. When is the last time you were surprised by your faith? Lent calls us to keep our eyes open so that we might see the new things that God is doing right here in our midst. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand and confess our faith by using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven,
was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and life for the world to come. Amen.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. You sent your Son that the world might be saved through him. Inspire the witness of the church throughout the world. Empower missionaries, Bible translators, ministries of service in your name. Bless our partners in ministry, our ELCA global partner churches, and young adults in global mission. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
From east to west, your steadfast love is shown. Nourish seas and deserts, wilderness, areas, and cities. Give water to thirsty lands, nurture spring growth that feeds hungry creatures. Bless farmers as they prepare for the growing season. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You sustain your people in the wilderness. Give courage to all who lead in times of crisis and scarce resources. Prosper the work of those who aid victims of famine and drought. Especially we pray for all those who are bringing about healing and vaccines throughout the land. Prosper their efforts. Bring peace in places where scarce resources cause violence. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Your mercy endures forever. Deliver all who cry to you, especially those who are hungry or without homes. We also pray for those who are sick and hurting, and in times of crisis, for Ralph, Richard, Colleen, Kathleen, Heather, Audrey, Carrie, Ron, June, Linda, Joe, and those who name before you in our hearts at this time. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
By grace we have been saved. Build this congregation to overflow with grace that we show mercy to others. Nourish any in our midst who are hungry, especially children, and bless our ministries of feeding and shelter. Give us patience and courage when the way seems long. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Your Son was lifted up, that whoever believes might have eternal life. We praise you for all who have died in Christ Bring us with all the saints into the fullness of your promises. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.